So we shall now go on to Dr. Jatinder Singh, who is heading the Department of Vitreoretina Uvea Services at the Eye Foundation Group of Hospitals, an excellent surgeon of great repute, to talk on challenges in the optic disc diagnosis and management. Could you share your screen, Dr. Jatinder? And welcome, Dr. Avinash.
Thank you, Dr. Chitra. Sorry, could not make it on time.
Thank you, Dr. Chitra, for your kind invitation. I'm here to, am I audible?
Yes, yes.
Okay, I'm here to speak on challenges in optic disc pit diagnosis and management. I have no financial interest. So optic disc pit is generally a clinical diagnosis. It's though not very common, its incidence is around 1 in 10,000 with no gender predilection. But diagnosis is based on the clinical appearance of a crater-like defect in the optic nerve head. Sometimes it may be associated with a darkening of the isthmus, a kind of a connection connecting neck between the disc and the macula. And that is the time you suspect it to be involving the macula, and that is optic disc pit maculopathy. So the OCT undisputedly is the best diagnostic tool for diagnosing a case of optic disc pit without maculopathy in doubtful cases. 70% of the pits are temporarily located, and of these, 50% of them, more than 50% of them, are likely to develop maculopathy. Centrally located pits are usually not associated with macular changes. However, on OCT, will sometimes show an early macular schisis or splitting of the retinal layers. And this kind of imaging would be helpful in monitoring these cases. This is an example of a large disc, a megalopapilla with a nasally located disc. Again, on fundus autofluorescence shows that there are some there is hyper autofluorescence in the infranasal region, suggesting that there was some leakage. Since it does not involve the macula, it is usually not it does not present clinically. Patients don't present with symptoms, and it is usually an incidental finding. So this is an example of normal fellow eye with the optic disc pit and disc coloboma. A disc coloboma which is not fully developed, it's a formifrostate disc coloboma with a large disc. Another example with pit in one eye and optic disc coloboma in the other eye. This coloboma is typically located along the choroidal fissure. As compared to a parapapillary choroidal atrophy that you see here, which is associated with a pit, but it is not a coloboma. So case of optic disc pit with optic disc coloboma is recently been termed as hybrid hybrid cavitary disc anomaly. So another example of an optic disc pit with retinochoroidal coloboma and iris coloboma. A megalopapillar disc can be associated with an optic disc pit in the fellow eye. So generally, to drive home the point that optic disc pit is probably a spectrum in the vast collection of diseases which involve the optic disc, this all collectively can safely be called as cavitary optic disc anomalies. This is a optic disc coloboma showing maculopathy. Not only these diseases or spectrum of diseases are similar in their presentation, as they confuse in the diagnosis with the appearance of the disc, but also the macular findings. Even the angiographic findings are quite similar. You would see a hypofluorescence related to the defect that is present on the optic nerve head because of the lack of the capillaries. This is a dysplastic disc with maculopathy. This is another patient with the optic disc coloboma and maculopathy. So let's take some examples. This is a young female who presented with decreased vision for 2 years, no history of trauma, and there was no maculopathy on the optic disc pit, on the OCT, but the fundus autofluorescence clearly shows an evidence that there was some amount involvement of the macula. So this probably comes under the category of occult pit, where you are not clinically able to see the pit, but there is evidence of either active or resolved macrosclerosis. This is a young male, a typical age of CSR. You can see a bullous-like elevation at the macula and a normal, relatively normal appearing disc. But the angiography clearly showed that there was hypofluorescence corresponding to a large, almost 3/4 of the disc had hypofluorescence because of lack of capillaries. So it is mentioned in the literature that the pits can be relatively very shallow and difficult to pick up at times. The depth of the pit can vary from 0.5 disc diameter, 0.5 diopters to 25 diopters. On the other hand, you can see a typical macular finding of a macrosclerosis, just like you see in a pit, but the fundus autofluorescence would show typical RPE atrophic tracts, suggestive of a complicated or a resolved teardrop CSR. Some cases of myopia, which show a lot of degenerative changes, can be associated with parapapillary retinoschisis or parapapillary schisis. Even in absence of degenerative changes in the macula, a myopic eye can show fractional maculopathy. The clinching point to diagnose this entity is normal zone, a lucid interval or lucid zone between the disc and the macular findings. This is another patient which showed some fluid at the macula. The disc was actually not very convincingly suggestive of optic disc pit. And you can see some hyperautofluorescent changes related to the macula. Infrotemporal to the right eye and infranasal to the macula in the left eye. The fluorescein angiography also showed some leakage, and this case was actually a tilted disc syndrome with maculopathy. You can see some fluid in the left eye as well. A nanophthalmic eye would also show coexistent optic disc hyperplasia and foveal hyperplasia, so it is easy to diagnose. A JXLR case can be diagnosed clinically as well because of the peripheral changes and also on ERG. So this is an interesting case of a young female who was treated as uveitis for macular edema with multiple Ozurdex and immunosuppression.
So you have 1 minute remaining.
This is an autofluorescence which shows an ERG which is corresponding to the diagnosis of enhanced S-cone syndrome. So there are other diagnoses like choroidal coloboma, choroidal hemangioma. This is the case of a congenital optic disc pigmentation, which will sometimes can get confused if you don't carefully look. It may look like a pit, large pit. It may look like a macular hole or a vitreomacular traction. The natural history of the disease is actually not so good. So that is why we have a lot of treatment options. But because of the rarity of the disease, there is not so clear understanding of the etiopathogenesis, that there is no clear clear-cut guidelines as to how to manage these cases. This is a case of type 3 CMVM related to optic disc pit, which was managed after 3 years and 10 anti-VEGF injections. There were some degenerative changes at the macula. So there are a lot of treatment options. Observation is a valid option in very young patients where spontaneous resolution is almost a rule. A young patient can be managed just with observation if the findings are very subtle. Some patients can be given topical carbonic anhydrase inhibitors. It may show
your time is up, sir.
Carry on, Jatinder.
So this is a case which was managed with vitrectomy, and because of the broad ILM peeling, developed a full thickness macular hole and a vision of 624. So my suggestion is to have a minimalistic inverted ILM flap technique with no peeling over the fovea, because that there is no pathology at the fovea, no endodrainage, no laser, no adjuvants, no intraocular gas, and no mandatory face down positioning. This is a video. In consideration of the time, I would skip the video. And this patient actually did well. This is a kind of a dream kind of case where you have a good resolution, and both patient and the surgeon have to be extremely lucky to have this outcome. Another patient, 55-year-old, You can see the membrane over the pit has been removed and it is replaced by an inverted flap. The patient had a decent outcome. Sometimes the structural restoration is well and the functional outcome may not be commensurate. This is a young female who had surgery once and then had a good resolution, developed a recurrence, had another surgery. And the second time I had placed a scleral, autologous scleral graft in the pit area. Subsequent to that, the patient had good resolution, 5 years of follow-up and maintaining 6/12 vision, though there are some skytic changes at the macula. This is a young patient, vision 615, had a laser photocoagulation done for the pit. There was no improvement, had a graft, developed a macular hole. And subsequent to that, just by observation, patient had a full thickness defect actually closed. Sometimes the patient may not be so lucky and may have to go in again to close the macular hole by an inverted island flap. At times, the patient after the surgery may develop lamellar in a lamellar hole. However, that usually does not affect the outcome. There is another entity called as acquired optic disc maculopathy, which all of you must be already aware of. I'll just run through these slides. This is a patient with glaucoma.
Summarize first. Yeah.
Yes. This is a patient with glaucoma who actually just with topical drops did well. And patient had a laser photocoagulation and then was switched to topical dorzolamide. So the conclusion, diagnosis should be, an alternative diagnosis should always be entertained before considering PIT as a working diagnosis. Look for ocular and systemic comorbidities. Multimodal imaging may help in better understanding the functional benefit of a proposed treatment. While offering the treatment, it should be, the risk and benefit should be judiciously evaluated. Expect very gradual and incomplete structural and functional recovery. And with the conventional non-foveal sparing ILM peeling, the macular hole is a very common complication. Thank you so much.
Thank you, Dr. Jatinder. As it's essentially also a PG update series, Dr. Avinash, I wanted to you to comment on what is the most accepted theory of for optic disc, optic pit maculopathy.
In terms of optic disc maculopathy, again, like what Jatinder has beautifully explained, that in terms of the fluid accumulation is what you're trying to ask.
Yeah.
So it has, again, there is no one hypothesis where people have acknowledged, because we have seen either way, either coming retrograde through the optic nerve, subretinal, that's the intracranial subarachnoid fluid which can come in. And or it could be from the vitreous. So either way, it is still a matter of debate, whichever it is. And we have seen it happens in both the ways. We have also seen, I think Dr. Mahesh Shanmugam is also there, very interesting case where he had to deal with a patient who had an optic disc coloboma with oil inside, and it had found its way in the into the chiasma area. So something like this can also happen sometimes in cavitation syndromes involving optic disc.
Dr. Mahesh, would you have anything to add?
A very nice presentation by Dr. Jatinder. He has covered everything. So laser photocoagulation is not done more often nowadays, but I would use that if the gap between the fluid and the optic nerve is very, very small, so that inflammation does close it. So younger patients where the fluid is not extending up to the macula, I would do laser. But otherwise, surgery seems to be the option.
Srinivas, I wanted to ask you, what kind of visual defect, field defect would you see in optic disc pit?
Basically, we have the scotomas present, as Mahesh sir rightly said. When we do a laser photocoagulation, we definitely see the visual field defects and the scotoma, and that's how we have stopped doing laser photocoagulation. And what I believe, the most common theory, which is also accepted as Avinash sir said, is probably because of the traction, the vitreous traction on the retina and the underlying area of Martigiani or bursa premacularis, that creates a kind of negative pressure and that tries to drive the fluid, the vitreous fluid or the cerebrospinal fluid. And that's how going into the submacular space, and that's how we describe it as ODPM, optic discrete maculopathy. And I think treatment options have been very nicely explained by Dr. Jatinder, sir. I totally agree with his points. There's no laser. But I have seen few patients who have been treated with macular buckle, and they have been done very well. But again, the challenges of the macular buckle is always there. I have done 15 cases where I have done inverted ILM plaque, like how we described. I don't do an ILM peeling over the oval area. And very nicely, he has shown it can cause a large macular hole. But I still feel that there is some negative pressure inside the pit. And that's how when we stuff the ILM, it stays very well. And even I think in Arvind also, Dr. Naresh Babu has published where he has put a scleral patch graph, and what Dr. Jatinder also showed it very nicely. Filling the pit, I think when there is a communication with the macula, I think that's the mainstay focus of treating these patients.
Thank you very much, Srinivas. And
Dr. Brodsky, shall we ask him, because he has written a chapter.
Yes, sure.
Dr. Michael Brodsky, any comments that you would like to make?
Yes, it's gratifying to see Harvey Linkoff. You know, he was a retina specialist in New York, and he was in his late 70s, and he described this mechanism of retinaschisis leading to macular hole, leading to serous retinal detachment with optic pits. And everybody thought he was crazy, and people derided him. And I remember arguing with our retina person that that's not a plausible mechanism. So it's nice with OCT to see that the clinical observations he made just by looking at the retina proved to be exactly accurate. I've seen a few cases of optic pit associated serous maculopathy in children, and there's been a few reported. And for whatever reason, maybe because the vitreous isn't pulling forward as much, those tend to resolve spontaneously in my experience. Now, it's a very small number, but so I think in children, when you see this, you want to sort of soft pedal it and not treat too quickly.
Thank you very much, Dr. Mike.
So, Chitra, I have just 2 points which could be of help for the postgraduates. First point is the disc which has the pit is usually larger than the other disc. That's the first point. And second point is, and we know that it's an important differential diagnosis for patients with central serous retinopathy. So anytime when one comes across a central serous retinopathy and it courses towards the disc like a flask shape and the fluid percolates towards the optic disc, so always try to rule out a pit. So those are the important two clinical points I would like to add.
Make one more point, just last point, Dr. You asked about the field effect. So you can see a central scotoma or an arcuate defect because the fluid is tracking to the macula. Second, most of the time, this optic disc pits are temporal, but there can be a pit-like structure which you can see on nasal side. And generally, those patients are likely to have NTG.
Yes, thank you very much. I had all these questions which needed the right answers. Thank you. Dr. Jatinder, your talk was really good.